The year was 1977. The deep-sea submersible DSV Alvin sank slowly through the inky black depths of the Pacific Ocean. On board was geologist Jack Corliss and his team of scientists, exploring hydrothermal vents along the Galapagos Rift, a volcanic hotspot far beneath the waves. There was no biologist among the crew. Why would there be? At 380 degrees Celsius, these waters were thought to be lifeless. But as Alvin's light pierced the darkness, the team was stunned. Not only was there life, there was an entire ecosystem unlike anything seen before. White crabs scuttling across the seafloor, giant mussels and clams, and towering above them all, long white tubes crowned with crimson plumes. These were worms, creatures we now know as Riftia pachyptela, the giant tube worms. This discovery didn't just reveal a new species, it rewrote the rules of biology. Today, we'll explore the world of tube worms, starting with their incredible diversity, and then zoom in on Riftia, the giant that thrives where life was never expected to exist. If you'd like to learn more, check out the document in the description with research papers and image credits. Riftia may be a relatively well-studied tube worm, but it's just one member of a remarkable family, the Siboglinidae. This group belongs within the annelid worms. You might know some of their relatives, earthworms or leeches. But the Siboglinids have abandoned the traditional way of life. Instead of feeding through a mouth and gut, the adults rely entirely on symbiotic bacteria to survive. This radical adaptation has allowed them to colonize some of the most extreme environments on Earth. The common name, tube worms, comes from the chitinous structure that they form around their bodies. The worms produce this themselves, using specialized glands to secrete chitin, which then hardens into a protective tube. There are only about 100 species of tube worms, a tiny fraction of the more than 22,000 species of annelid worms. But these 100 are some of the most fascinating, with adaptations that reach the limits of biology. Tube worms are divided into four main groups. First, frenulata, or beard worms. These were the earliest tube worms to be discovered, but they remain among the least studied. Why? Because they are incredibly fragile. Most are thread-like, only 0.1 to 3 millimeters in diameter. That means they're often destroyed accidentally when caught as bycatch or preserved incorrectly, making intact specimens rare. Frenulata are the most diverse clade of Siboglinidae and typically live in deep, muddy sediments, surviving in highly anoxic, oxygen-poor conditions. Next is the genus Osidex. This is an odd group whose placement among the other clades is still debated. They have a highly unique lifestyle, reflected in their common names, bone worms, zombie worms, or bone-eating worms. Only discovered in 2002, bone worms specialize in boring into whale bones. They feed on the proteins and collagen inside the bone, with the help of specialized bacteria, a process known as bioerosion. It's a striking example of life recycling death in the deep sea. The third clade is sclerolenum. They inhabit cold seeps, areas where chemicals like methane and sulfide escape from cracks in the ocean floor. These seeps may sound similar to hydrothermal vents, but they lack the extreme heat and tend to be more stable in long-lasting environments. Despite only having a single genus, this has allowed sclerolenum to spread widely. In fact, one species, Sclerolenum contortum, is considered cosmopolitan, found from Arctic mud volcanoes to the Southern Ocean and even the much warmer Gulf of Mexico. That's an extraordinary range for any animal, let alone a deep-sea specialist. Finally, Vestimentifera. This group includes some of the most iconic tube worms, like Riftia, a giant friend from the introduction. Vestimentiferans are among the most common animals found around hydrothermal vents. As adults, they gather in dense colonies, often thousands strong. They anchor themselves into the vent rock, using a root-like structure that burrows deep into the substrate. These roots entangle with those of neighboring worms, forming mats that stabilize the vent community. Examining these roots has proven challenging. They're delicate and nearly impossible to extract intact. But roots longer than 30 meters have been recorded, making them some of the most extensive structures in the deep sea. And This brings us back to the strange red-plumed worms that stunned the geologists in 1977. Riftia pachyptila, the giant tube worms, a species whose biology defies expectation. Riftia pachyptila is among the largest and most spectacular of all annelid worms. Fully grown adults can reach around 2 meters in length, with some of the biggest individuals stretching closer to 2.4 meters, taller than most people standing upright on land. Yet, despite their size, they remain surprisingly delicate, soft-bodied animals, protected only by the chitinous tubes they build around themselves. For much of their lives, these giants form dense colonies clustered around hydrothermal vents. The vent landscape is divided into zones. The hottest, most sulfide-rich water gushes directly from the chimneys, while cooler, more mixed water surrounds them. Riftia occupy a very particular band within this gradient, close enough to access the chemicals their symbiotic bacteria require, but far enough from the superheated flow to avoid being cooked alive. At thriving vent fields, thousands of tubes can stand packed together, swaying gently in the current like a crimson-tipped forest. Despite their imposing size and abundance, Riftia remain some of the strangest animals ever discovered. Adults have no mouth, no gut, no anus. They cannot feed in any way we would recognize. And yet, they grow rapidly, reach enormous lengths, and sustain entire ecosystems around them. So, how does an animal survive, let alone thrive, without the ability to eat? The answer lies at the heart of their biology, and it has reshaped our understanding of life in the deep. To understand how Riftia survives, we need to look at their anatomy, a body plan so heavily re-engineered by evolution that it barely resembles that of a typical worm. The most striking feature is the plume, that brilliant red crown emerging from the top of the tube. This isn't just a decoration, it's a massive gas exchange organ, packed with blood vessels. The red color comes from specialized hemoglobin, which can bind oxygen and hydrogen sulfide, a chemical that would be lethal to most animals. The plume unfurls when conditions are safe, absorbing the gases the worm needs, and retracts immediately when danger approaches or the water becomes too hot. Just below the plume sits the vestimentum, a muscular collar that helps anchor the worm inside its tube. It also plays a key role in controlling water flow into the worm's body cavity. Important because with no mouth or digestive tract, Riftia rely entirely on circulating seawater through internal structures to support their symbiotic bacteria. When the worm withdraws fully, the plume is sealed off by a structure called the operculum. Think of it as a living plug, protecting the delicate tissues from predators, heat pulses, and debris stirred up by vent activity. All of this is housed within the tube, a flexible but durable structure made entirely of chitin and secreted by the worm's skin. Unlike a snail shell, the tube grows gradually as the worm extends its body, forming a protective outer casing. Over time, tubes can become encrusted with minerals precipitating from the vent fluids, giving old colonies a weathered, rock-like appearance. Unlike some of the closely related tube worm species, Riftia does not have the root system I described earlier. It simply doesn't need it. Its tube helps anchor it to hydrothermal vents, and the surrounding water is so abundant in the required chemicals that it doesn't require roots to help it gather more from the nearby substrate. Supporting all of this is a remarkably adapted circulatory system. Riftia have hemoglobin, unlike that of any vertebrate, enormous, free-floating molecules that can safely transport both oxygen and toxic hydrogen sulfide through the bloodstream at the same time. This allows the worm to deliver these gases to the internal organ where the real magic happens, the trophosome, home to the symbiotic bacteria. At the core of Riftia's biology lies one of the most remarkable partnerships in the natural world, a symbiosis so complete that the worm no longer needs a mouth, a stomach, or even an intestine. Instead, nearly the entire trunk of the animal is filled by a single specialized organ, the trophosome. The trophosome houses billions of chemosynthetic bacteria, packed into lobes of tissue that look almost like a honeycomb. These bacteria are the true engines of the worm's metabolism. Instead of relying on sunlight, they draw energy from chemicals rising from the vents, particularly hydrogen sulfide. Using sulfide as a fuel source and oxygen as an oxidizing agent, they perform chemosynthesis, producing carbohydrates that feed the worm. For this partnership to work, the worm must supply the bacteria with everything they need. That's where Riftia's strange anatomy becomes essential. The red plume absorbs oxygen and sulfide from the surrounding water, while the circulatory system, with its unusual hemoglobin, transports both safely to the trophosome. The bacteria, in return, manufacture all the carbohydrates and nutrients the worm requires. Riftia is, in effect, a living greenhouse, tending its internal crop. This arrangement is so efficient that it fuels astonishing biomass. At thriving hydrothermal vents, dense thickets of giant tube worms can carpet the seafloor, forming some of the most productive ecosystems on the planet, despite existing in total darkness and relying on no external food source. A long-standing question was how each new generation of worms obtain its symbionts. Do parents pass them on directly to their offspring? Or do the bacteria come from the environment? Research now shows that Riftia acquire their bacteria horizontally. Larvae hatch without any of these bacteria. Only after they settle near an active vent do the bacteria invade through the skin and colonize the developing trophosome. Once that process is complete, the window closes, and the worm becomes entirely dependent on its new internal partners for the rest of its life. It's a system that turns the rules of animal biology on their head. An animal that survives not by eating, but by cultivating an internal community of microbes that can harvest chemical energy from the earth itself. For an animal that feeds without a mouth, Riftia has a surprisingly conventional beginning. Adults may have completely abandoned their digestive system, but their larvae have one, and use it. Riftia reproduce by releasing eggs and sperm into the water column, where fertilization occurs externally. The embryos develop into tiny, free-swimming larvae equipped with a functional mouth, gut, and cilia for movement. At this stage, they behave much like other marine invertebrate larvae. They swim, they feed, and they drift on the currents in search for a place to settle. What they're searching for, however, is highly specific. Settlement cues appear to include elevated sulfide concentrations, the chemical signature of an active vent, and the presence of microbial mats that thrive in these zones. When larvae detect these conditions, they undergo a dramatic transformation. After attaching to the vent rock, the gut begins to degenerate, collapsing as the trophosome develops in its place. Around the same time, the window opens for symbiote invasion. Chemosynthetic bacteria from the environment enter through the larval skin and take up residence in the trophosome. Once the symbiosis is established, the larva no longer needs to feed. The mouth and digestive tract finish disappearing, and the worm begins its new life as a chemoautotrophic adult. It's a life cycle unlike anything on land. A floating larva with a mouth and stomach that becomes a giant sessile adult, running entirely on chemical energy. Evolution in this corner of the planet has taken a very different path. Life around hydrothermal vents is precarious. Vents are temporary landscapes, appearing where magma heats seawater and vanishing when eruptions, tectonic shifts, or mineral deposits can collapse the chimneys. Some vents can last decades, or they can collapse overnight. For the animals that live there, survival is a race against time. Grow fast or die. And few invertebrates grow faster than Riftia pickup tailor. Juveniles can put on as much as 85 centimeters in a single year, quickly reaching the size and metabolic capacity to dominate their patch of the seafloor. This extraordinary growth allows them to outcompete other species, like the smaller tube worm Tevnia or dense mussel beds, securing access to hydrogen sulfide and oxygen while there is still a vent to exploit. This grow-fast strategy is a remarkable example of evolution responding to an unstable habitat. Only by rapidly exploiting the resources of a vent can a species ensure it reproduces before its home disappears. And in doing so, Riftia sets the stage for the entire vent community that will form around it. When vents collapse, adults die, but larvae can recolonize new or regenerated chimneys, continuing the cycle in a world that is constantly reshaping itself. Riftia are more than just inhabitants of hydrothermal vents. They are foundation species, shaping the very structure of the ecosystem. Their densely packed tubes provide surface area for other animals and microbes to colonize and stabilize the otherwise fragile vent substrate. These tube worm forests also support a surprising array of predators. Fish, vent crabs, and other animals navigate the tubes, feeding opportunistically or using them for shelter. And when a vent field dies or the worms themselves perish, the ecosystem undergoes dramatic changes. The collapse of a Riftia colony can restructure the entire vent community, removing the habitat and resources that other species depend on. In short, these worms are not just residents of the vents, they are engineers of their environment, turning a barren, chemically extreme landscape into a bustling, highly productive ecosystem. The astonishing adaptations of Riftia didn't appear out of nowhere. Vestimentiferan tube worms likely evolved from ancestors that lived at cold seeps, environments where hydrogen sulfide is present, but temperatures are milder. Fossil tubes resembling modern vestimentiferans provide tantalizing hints that this lineage has been exploiting chemosynthetic resources for millions of years. Their earlier relatives, like Frenulata, are smaller, softer worms living in oxygen-poor sediments. Like Riftia, they rely on symbiotic bacteria, though in less extreme environments, suggesting that chemosymbiosis arose first in these more stable, low-oxygen habitats before being perfected for the high-temperature, sulfide-rich world of hydrothermal vents. In such extreme conditions, the combination of rapid chemical energy availability and minimal competition made vent life an ideal stage for evolution to push the limits. By harnessing chemosynthesis, Riftia transformed a barren, superheated seafloor into one of the most productive ecosystems on Earth, and, along the way, reshaped our understanding of what life can do. Hydrothermal vents may seem remote and untouchable, but they are increasingly exposed to human activity. The mineral-rich deposits surrounding vents, including rare earth minerals, sulfides, and cobalt crusts, are of growing interest for deep-sea mining. Disturbance from mining could destroy entire vent fields, wiping out colonies of Riftia and other specialized organisms before we even fully understand them. Vents are fragile ecosystems. Unlike forests or coral reefs, their communities exist in small, isolated patches, and recovery after disruption can take decades, if it happens at all. This makes the protection of known vent sites crucial, not just for preserving individual species, but for maintaining the complex network of life that thrives around them. Beyond conservation, vents are windows into Earth's past and perhaps its future. Studying organisms like Riftia helps us understand how life might have survived in extreme conditions on the early Earth, and even guides the search for life on other planets or moons with hydrothermal activity. Protecting these unique habitats ensures that these scientific discoveries and the extraordinary life they host are not lost before their secrets are fully revealed. From the first moment Alvin's lights revealed those crimson plumes in 1977, Riftia picapteela has captured our imagination. These giant tube worms challenge everything we thought we knew about life, surviving without a mouth or gut, growing to astonishing sizes, and forming dense colonies that turn barren, superheated rocks into thriving ecosystems. Their extraordinary anatomy, their intricate symbiosis, and chemosynthetic bacteria, and the rapid life cycles that allow them to colonize ephemeral vent fields, show just how versatile and inventive evolution can be. Yet their story is more than a tale of survival. It's a story of ecological engineering, shaping entire communities in one of the harshest habitats on Earth. And as we continue to study these remarkable worms, we are reminded that hydrothermal vents are fragile and finite. Protecting these ecosystems not only preserves the incredible biodiversity they host, but also safeguards the scientific insights they offer into life on our planet, and possibly life beyond it. I hope you enjoyed this journey into the world of Riftia. If this video sparked your curiosity, don't let it stop here. Share it, talk about it, and keep learning. There's still so much to discover about the world's rare and remarkable species, and the more we understand, the better our chances of protecting them. Thanks for watching.